Saint Augustine was one of the, is one of the great figures of church history. Lived from 354 AD to 430. The story is told of him being on his deathbed. He's laying there and he quits breathing. His heart stops. And a wonderful peace fills the room. Just this strong sense of God's presence as his friends look at this body that has stopped functioning. And after a couple of minutes, suddenly Augustine's eyes open wide. And this is what history says happened. He said, "I have seen the Lord, and everything I wrote about him is straw. I have seen the Lord, and he wrote a lot, and everything I wrote about him is straw." I think that's a reminder to all of us that we need to approach God's Word. We need to approach theology. We need to approach our musings and our discussions and our debates about who God is and what God acts like and what God thinks is important with a great, great, great deal of humility. One of the profoundest, most prolific writers in all of church history dies and says, "I have seen the Lord, and everything I have written is but straw. I've seen the Lord, and everything I've written is but straw." As I worked through the portion of Scripture that we are looking at this morning as we continue the Sermon Central series, New Testament Central series, I realize that my understanding of God, while it is growing, is far from what it should be, and I have to be honest, Romans chapter 1 has really stretched me. Romans 1 has really stretched me. Because the God I had created in my thoughts, I was much more comfortable with than the God I read about in Romans chapter 1. I have seen the Lord, and everything I wrote about him is but straw. Let's stand together one more time until the next time. And I think it's good for us to read this word together out loud and allow God's Spirit to penetrate our hearts. This is a long portion, maybe one of the longest portions we've ever read together as a church in the last 15 years, but may God by his Spirit speak to us. Romans chapter 1, beginning at verse number 18. "For the wrath of God is revealed from heaven against all ungodliness and unrighteousness of man who suppress the truth in unrighteousness. Because that which is known about God is evident within them, for God made it evident to them. For since the creation of the world, his invisible attributes, his eternal power and divine nature have been clearly seen, being understood through what has been made, so that they are without excuse. For even though they knew God, they did not honor him as God or give thanks, but they became futile in their speculations, and their foolish heart was darkened. Professing to be wise, they became fools and exchanged the glory of the incorruptible God for an image in the form of corruptible man, and of birds and four-footed animals and crawling creatures. Therefore, God gave them over in the lusts of their hearts to impurity, so that their bodies would be dishonored among them. For they exchanged the truth of God for a lie, and worshipped and served the creature rather than the Creator, who is blessed forever. Amen. For this reason, God gave them over to degrading passions, for the women exchanged the natural function for that which is unnatural. And in the same way also the men abandoned the natural function of the woman and burned in their desire toward one another, man with man committing indecent acts and receiving in their own persons the due penalty of their error. And just as they did not see fit to acknowledge God any longer, God gave them over to a depraved mind and to do those things which are not proper, being filled with all unrighteousness, wickedness, greed, evil, full of envy, murder, strife, deceit, malice. They're gossips, slanderers, haters of God, insolent, arrogant, boastful, inventors of evil, disobedient to parents, without understanding, untrustworthy, unloving, unmerciful. And although they know the ordinance of God, that those who practice such things are worthy of death, they not only do the same, but also give hearty approval to those who practice them. Wow. What a portion. What a portion. You may be seated. A lot of the preaching that comes out of these verses at the end of chapter Romans seem to concentrate on what I would describe as the couple of rather almost X-rated verses on immorality, verses 26 and 27. And in doing that, I think they draw attention away from the larger truth of this portion. The truth that I think really is what the apostle is trying to get across here. And the larger, more encompassing truth is what I'm going to call the three paradidome. And I know that's not real catchy, but paradidome is a Greek word that shows up in this portion three times. And the three times it shows up, it's translated God gave them over or God gave them up. And so we see in this portion God giving up, God giving them over because, number one, of their moral uncleanness, in verse number 26, for their vile passions, and in verse number 28, because of their depraved mind and their unrighteousness. So the theme of this, the end of this chapter is the reality that God gave up on people, on mankind. I suggest most of you right now are saying, well, I don't like this. Matter of fact, I have never even thought about God giving up. I don't like the idea that maybe God has given up on us. So I'll pay attention next week. Right now I'm going to start thinking about my Christmas shopping list. The problem with that is we're saying, I've already made my mind up about what God is, what God is like. And we're more comfortable with our own straw God than the real God. And my heart's desire for the neighborhood church is for us to be people who are are deeply committed to knowing God in fullness. And I don't think there is any better place to know God in fullness than to spend time delving into God's Word and figuring out what God has revealed to us about Himself. And so in this chapter, we're exposed to this God who gives up, gave them up, turned them over. Why did He do that? Romans chapter 1 and verse number 18. Here's another phrase we don't like when we think about God. The wrath of God. For the wrath of God is revealed from heaven against all ungodliness and unrighteousness of man who suppress the truth in unrighteousness. What is the thing that God ultimately finds offensive about mankind? What is the thing that God ultimately finds offensive about mankind? We suppress truth. We repress truth. We don't want to deal the truth. We don't want to hear the truth. I was praying at our venue in Martinsville this morning before service, and I felt challenged by the Lord to, as I was preparing to preach, to read through this text one more time. And so I read through Romans 1, 18 to 32 in that prayer time at Martinsville. And the phrase that stuck out to me, it was in verse 21, where it describes mankind as becoming futile in their speculations. Futile in their speculations. We repress truth, we speculate a lot, and all of that has made us futile. And the problem with suppressing the truth in unrighteousness became even more real to me when this week I reread this in the Amplified Classic Version, and catch what it says about suppressing the truth at the end of the verse, highlighted in red for you. They repress and hinder the truth and make it inoperative. They repress and hinder the truth and make it inoperative. So what happens to mankind, what happens to us when we say, well, the truth's not that important, I don't care what the truth says, I've already decided who God is, what God looks like, I've decided how I want to live, it doesn't matter what the Bible says. When we repress the truth, what happens in our lives? The truth becomes inoperative. The truth no longer works for us. The truth no longer works for us. So it's a very dangerous thing, a very foolish thing to suppress the truth. It's a very dangerous thing to believe a lie. And we just don't want to be there. So let me take you back to the chart we ended with last Sunday morning. And this is not so it looks better on YouTube, well, because we've got more listens. But if you missed last Sunday's message, I really would encourage you to get on our website this afternoon and listen to last weekend's teaching, because that's so fundamental to understanding where we're going in the book of Romans. But let me just do a quick review here. We were made originally as eternal creations in the image of God. Every one of us was made, this was God's original intention, God's original purpose for all of us. Every one of us was made in His image with the goal and the desire that we should live forever and ever and ever and ever and ever and ever and ever and ever. Never die. That was God's plan. And then Adam believed the lie, and sin and death entered the world. Adam believed the lie, and sin and death entered the world. And the accompanying pain and futility of life, impurity and depravity. Now, what I'm talking about this morning is the power of the gospel to change all of that. And so if you have made a decision in your life to believe the gospel and to live for Jesus Christ, you have rejected Adam's belief of a lie, and you've chosen to believe the truth, all of that has changed. So what I'm talking about this morning is the way life is on the left-hand side of that chart. I'm talking about the way life is on the left-hand side of that chart. I hope almost everybody here this morning is living on the right-hand side of it. I hope almost everyone here is living on the right-hand side of it. But if you're here today and you haven't yet believed the truth, you haven't said yes to the gospel of Christ, I want you to understand where you're at, but I want to remind all of us where we used to be. And then I also want to remind us that getting to the top of that right-hand side is a process. And we still are infected and affected and effected by some of that left-hand side of the chart. And we have to guard ourselves from it. So why did God give them up? Why did God give them up? Well, Romans chapter 1 and verse 21 says, for even though they knew God, they did not honor him as God. So they knew God existed, but they refused to make him God. They refused to give him the honor. So reason one, God gave them up. Second reason, verse number 22, they thought they were smart. They thought they were smart. The only right place for any of us to position ourselves before God is a place of humility. Can I repeat that just in case we all think we're smart still? The only right place for any of us to position ourselves before God is a position of humility. These guys thought they were smart. They were professing themselves to be wise. I'm smart. I got it all figured out. Third reason is they made God in their own image. I'll get back to that later. But it's really possible, friends, for us to build straw gods that we're comfortable with. It's really possible for us to build straw gods that we're comfortable with. So God gives up on them. Now, you say, and I'm going to ask Pastor Bob Williamson to just come and help me here for a minute. What's the best mic for him to use here? That one? Just grab that one there, Bob, as you come over. And I just want us to look at a few portions here. And I'll find the first one here as we go through this journey. Genesis chapter 3 and verse number 5. For God knows that in the day you eat from it, your eyes will be opened and you will be like God, knowing good and evil. So why did Adam and Eve even eat that apple? Why did they do that? So they could be like God. They wanted everything God had. They didn't want God to be positioned in a place where he had something and knew something they didn't know. They wanted to be equal with God. Not in the image of God. They wanted to be equal with God. It got them in trouble. Read a few verses here for me. Read one at a time and I'll kind of comment. Exodus chapter 32 and verse 1.
When the people saw that Moses was so long in coming down from the mountain, they gathered around Aaron and said, "Come, let us make gods who will go before us. As for this fellow Moses who brought us up out of Egypt, we don't know what's happened to him."
So here's the children of Israel. Moses, their pastor, their spiritual leader, says, "I'm going away for 40 days. I'm going to seek God's presence. I'm going to find out what God wants to say to us." And while they are gone, while their leader is gone, what do they make? They make gods. We have a real tendency, friends, to build gods in our lives. We have a real tendency to build gods in our lives. Keep going.
He took what they had handed him, and they made it into an idol cast in the shape of a calf, fashioned it with a tool. Then they said, "These are your gods, O Israel, who brought you up out of Egypt."
Huh. So what are they making? They're making their own god or gods. But who do they say? Well, read verse 5, and then I'll comment on this.
When Aaron saw this, he built an altar in front of the calf and announced, "Tomorrow there will be a festival to the Lord."
So they build this God, and then who do they declare this God to be? This is the God who brought you out of Egypt. This is the real, this is what the God looks like. The God who's helped you here. And then the next day, what do they have? They have a church service to worship this God. Friends, we are very drawn to making a God that we're comfortable with. We want a God we can understand. We want a God that fits in our boxes. We want a God we can package and explain. They weren't comfortable with a God who Moses might be learning about on top of a mountain. And everybody knows that was taking too long anyhow. So they made their own God. Next portion I wanted you to read for us was Isaiah 29, was it Isaiah or Acts? Acts, go to Acts.
Acts chapter 7, verse 43. You have lifted up the shrine of Moloch and the star of your god, Rephim, the idols you have made to worship. Therefore, I will send you into exile beyond Babylon.
So Israel's not learning anything. Now, this is the Babylonian exile, and what are they still making? They're making gods. Isaiah, we'll end with this. Thank you, Pastor Bob. Good help this morning.
The Lord said, these people came near to me with their mouth, and they honored me with their lips, but their hearts are far from me. Their worship of me is made up only of rules taught by men.
Huh. So our worship is not worship based on who God really is, but how do we worship God? We have formed God, made God, packaged God based on rules made by man. We build our straw God. We build our straw God. It's more comfortable to have a straw God that fits into our box, fits into a box that we can carry around and explain to everybody. Having a God that is unexplainable doesn't work for us. Having a God that is unexplainable doesn't work for us. But I have news for us this morning. Are you ready for it? I'm getting up on the platform here where it's safer. God is unexplainable. And if you've got a God you can explain and make formulas about, and they'll always click together really neat, you've made a straw God. I knew you'd like that. So we've made God in our, we're inclined to make God in our own image. So this Greek word, paradidomai, shows up 121 times in the New Testament. It's that phrase that is translated in the New American Standard Version. The phrase translated, God gave them over. I think King James Version says God gave them up. 121 times in the New Testament. Here's one of those times. I'm taking two examples out of the crucifixion story. Now Judas was betraying him. Gave them a sign saying, whomever I kiss, he's the one. Betraying is the word parodidome. He just this is the guy. He gave him over. Matthew chapter 27, verse 26, Pilate released Barabbas for them, but after having Jesus scourged, he handed him over to be crucified. The word there, paradidome, is he handed him over. So God hands us over. What does he hand us over to? Why did he do it? Let's talk about why God handed us over. Why God handed us over. There's two primary views on this. So if you're reading books like I have in my library, you'll hear people argue about which of these it is that God did. And the first is the argument that God does this passively. So God just withdraws his restraining and protective hand. Jonathan Edwards preached a sermon, Sinners in the Hands of the Angry God. And in there, the argument, our presentation is The only reason we even survive is because God is, he's angry, but at least he's holding us. And the argument here is that God just withdraws his hands, his restraining and protective hand. Acts chapter 14, 16, they use as one of their supporting scriptures, because if you're going to build a God, you've got to have a verse at least that supports it. In the generations gone by, he permitted all the nations to go their own ways. So the argument is God just permits things. He lets them happen. He's not planned, not part of it, but he's permitting it. He lets it happen. The second primary view is God is actively handing us over to experience the consequence of sin. And of course, the theologians who are there have a scripture verse to support it too. And one of the first ones is Genesis chapter 3, verse 17. They say this is how God operates. God said to Adam, because you've listened to the voice of your wife. Wasn't that in last week's sermon too? Because you've listened to the voice of your wife and have eaten from the tree about which I commanded you, saying, you shall not eat from it. Cursed is the ground because of you, and toil you eat of it all the days. So God took action when they believed the lie. God just didn't sit passively back and say, whatever's going to be is going to be. God took real action. Romans chapter 12, verse 19. Never take your own revenge, beloved, but leave room for the wrath of God. There's that phrase we don't like. It's in Scripture a lot more than you realize, especially once the preacher points it out. Leave room for the wrath of God, for it is written, vengeance is mine, I will repay. So the Lord takes steps where he does repay. So we got this argument, says God handing mankind over to the stuff we read about in the last 10 verses or so of this chapter. Or is that a passive action or is it an active? I want to throw out a third suggestion this morning and suggest that probably the best place for us to land is both and. Both and. And I think Scripture supports that. So let's go to Ephesians chapter 4, verses 17 to 19. So this I say and affirm together with the Lord, that you walk no longer just as the Gentiles also walk in the futility of their mind, being darkened in their understanding, excluded from the life of God because of the ignorance that is in them, because of the hardness of their heart, and they, having become callous, have given themselves over to sensuality for the practice of every kind of impurity with greediness. Now, when I read that, I feel like I'm reading a little bit of the same stuff that's in Romans. The same kind of, you end up in every kind of impurity with greediness, but it reads different. In Romans, God is handing them over, but what's happening here? They are giving themselves over to. So here, God is passive. In Romans, God is active. The story of Exodus, I think, gives some insight here, too. And we won't look all the texts up, but if you're a note taker, when God is asking, Moses is asking Pharaoh to let God's people go out of the land of Egypt, we see that God hardens Pharaoh's heart. So God's active there. But we also see a number of scriptures that also says Pharaoh hardens his own heart. So I think there's this interaction in our lives because God respects our free will. There's this interaction between God's will and our will. And sometimes God steps in there and God takes action. But you can't blame everything that happens in your life on God. You can't blame everything that happens in your life on God. Many of the problems in my life are not God's fault, they're John's fault. So there's this interaction between God working and our poor decisions and our poor choices. What I really need to talk about, though, this afternoon before we end is, why does this matter? Why does this portion of Scripture matter? And I want to give you five reasons why I think this is a really important portion of Scripture. And the first reason this portion matters is it's another reminder that we must not make God in our own image. Do you catch where all of this turning them over starts from? Do you catch the verse immediately before it? Why does God turn them over? Because they exchanged the glory of the incorruptible God, this God who is not explainable, who is glorious, who is so much different than us, so much holier. They took the glory of this unexplainable God and they tried to make him into an image that they could touch and feel and make understandable. We must not, friends, make God in our own image. We must not be there. And we're inclined to get there very easily. Some of us at some points in our lives have got angry at God because he doesn't seem to be serving us very well. Show me where in Scripture God's supposed to serve you. We're not God who has this servant called Jehovah. We are God's servants, bond servants of the Lord Jesus Christ. We serve him. But we make a God in our own image that says, well, God, here's what I need. I'll just tell you about it this morning and look after it by 6, please. A lot of us think we've given our lives to Christ and have chosen to become Christians so that God will make us happy. We think God's great purpose for our existence is to make us happy. Happy, 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 happy. My understanding of the God of Scripture is we've been created to bring joy to him and praise to him and honor to him and glory to him. We exist not, he does not exist for us, we exist for him. And we don't wake up in the morning saying, oh God, make me happy today. I want to be happy, happy, happy. We wake up in the morning and say, oh God, I want this day to bring great joy to you. We have to be very, very careful, friends, not to build a God in our own image. Secondly, it reminds us that sin is dangerous and destructive. I think we get very used to sin. We get very used to sin in our own hearts and our own lives. We get very used to sin in our culture. The stuff that many of us are comfortable watching on television now would make our grandparents vomit in their graves. We get used to sin. And we don't remember how destructive and damaging it is. When God sees sin, he deals with it. I mean, it enters the world, and God says, I can't let this go on forever and ever. My plan was for you to live for and never die. You're meant to be eternal beings. But sin has entered now, and if sin is allowed to exist forever, it's going to ruin everything. And so sin has a shelf life. We have a shelf life because of sin. Sin is dangerous, and sin is destructive. And we read that list at the end of Romans, wherever that last chapter, that last paragraph is. And I read it in my family room a week ago Friday. I told you this last Sunday. And I was broken as I read it because I saw too much of me in it. And we read about greed and we think, oh yeah, greed is a terrible thing because If I'm greedy, all I do is work. And I miss the fun of life. The problem with greed is not that you work hard and you have lots of money in your bank. The problem with greed is you're worshiping the pursuit of money instead of honoring God with your life. And we become the God. Pride is listed at the end of that chapter. And the problem with pride is not that you lose all your friends because you always know the answers. The problem with pride is you're exalting yourself above everybody else and you're exalting yourself above God. And you're saying, God, I'm smart. I've figured everything out. And you're not letting him be the voice of wisdom in your heart and in your life. Reminds us this portion that sin is dangerous and destructive. Number three, it enforces the need to not resist God's call. 2 Corinthians chapter 4 and verse 6, God who said, light shall shine out of darkness, is the one who has shone in our hearts to give the light of the knowledge of the glory of God in the face of Christ. Friends, we walk in darkness. We walk in darkness. And God in his grace comes with these meets us in our depravity and meets us in the darkness of our heart, and he shines a light in and he reveals Jesus to us. It's a very dangerous thing to not pay attention to the light, because our natural state is to love darkness, and we're inclined to go back there over and over again. And when God in his mercy, if he ever comes, and thank God he's come to almost all of us, but if he ever comes and he shows you his light and he calls you to himself, it's a dangerous thing to say no to the light. It's a dangerous thing to resist God's call, because our natural tendency is to want to be there. We've been given over to that. Fourth reason this threefold paradidome is important is because it increases our love for God. You see, I don't think we really appreciate our salvation until we really appreciate how much pain and that sin has caused in our lives. I don't think we really appreciate our salvation until we realize the great price Christ has paid for us in order that we no longer be in sin, no longer need to be on the left-hand side of the chart. I am not like some who think that the courses that are being written now are frothy. I think a lot of the music that's been written in the last 20 years is among the best music and the best worship the church has ever had written. It is deep stuff. It is theologically strong. I can't say that I share that conviction about a lot of the stuff that was written in the 80s and 90s. That most of us think is wonderful. A lot of it's pretty frivolous. But I miss some of the real old hymns, because there's a depth to them too. That hymn, Love Lifted Me, I hope I can remember enough of to quote some of it here. I was sinking deep in sin, far from the peaceful shore. Very deeply stained within, sinking to rise no more. That's where we were, friends. Then the master of the sea heard our despairing cry and from the waters lifted me. Now safe am I, friends. We were in the mess that is described in Romans chapter 1 here. We lived on that back end of that chapter. God had given us over. God had said, you want to live like that? Live like that. But God saw us sinking, and he reached down, and he lifted us up. Love lifted us up. Now safe are we. And friends, we need to remember where we've come from. We need to be brought back there over and over and over again. And lastly, thank you for not saying thank you, Jesus. Lastly, genuine, from the heart worship matters. genuine, from the heart worship matters. What got us in the mess? We began to build a straw God. We made God in our own image. And we began to worship this God that we had made up. And God says, well, believe what you want to believe. Go where you want to go. Genuine worship of the true God is so important in our lives, friends. How do you know what you worship? Worship band, coming along, please, as we just end with an expression of genuine worship today. How do you know what you worship? What do you spend most of your time thinking about? It's a good clue. What do you spend most of your time on? It's a good clue. And what do you use most of your disposable income on? That tells you what you're really worshiping. We got to make sure we don't have a bunch of straw gods. Not building a life on false gods. But do we want to know Him who is the true God, the unexplainable God, the high and lifted up God, the exalted God, the almighty God, the altogether holy God? That's the God we want to know. We want to know the God who is great, the God who is big, the God who is awesome, the God who is high and lifted up. And we are not going to settle for worshiping a straw God. We're not going to settle for worshiping a straw God. So as we conclude this morning, I invite you to stand. I invite you to offer your worship to the holy, to the almighty God. But I ask you to ask God as we conclude this morning. I ask you to ask God as we conclude this morning to grant to you a new and a fresh and a deep revelation of who God really is.